additional questions, comments? All those in favor? Carried. And that brings us back to bylaws. Okay.
Just maybe clear, just whenever, and I know that it was here before, but just for some of us that are more challenged when it comes to keeping track of these applications, when we've already had the discussion, but could you just, I know you can go and look up on the map, but if you always just had a thing like that, even just with these staff reports, it just, I know it's an extra page, but we'd appreciate it if you felt like you could do that, please.
Okay, so. Bylaw 2017-133. 32. 32. Be resolved that bylaw number 2017-132, being a bylaw to amend zoning bylaw number 19-2002, entitled the Township of Southgate zoning bylaw, be read a first, second, and third time, finally passed, signed by the mayor and the clerk, sealed with the seal of incorporation, and entered into the bylaw book. Who would like to move that? Dale and Jim. Discussion? All those in favor? Carried. Bylaw 2017-133. Be resolved that bylaw number 2017-133, being a bylaw to amend zoning bylaw number 19-2002, entitled the Township of Southgate zoning bylaw, be read first, second, and third time, finally passed, signed by the mayor and the clerk, sealed with the seal of incorporation, and entered into the bylaw book. And who would like to move that? Jim and John. Discussion? All those in favor? Carried. Enjoy your afternoon, Clint.
Thank you.
Okay, so.
I know it's a half hour away, but I think that we need a motion to go past noon to at least keep going if we get into a discussion rather than interrupting the discussion, no matter where we are.
Okay, so Barbara moves that we proceed past noon. It sounds like only as required to finish any pending discussion. Would anybody like to second that? Dale? Any discussion on that? All those in favor? Carried. Okay, so, clerk's report? Be resolved that council receives staff report CL 2017-043 for information, and that the 2018 municipal elections procedures be made available on the website as of January 1st, 2018, and distributed to all candidates through election packages. Would you like to move that? Jim and Barbara, discussion? I think I'm going to let the clerk start.
So through the mayor, members of council, so these procedures, according to the new municipal law, are not required to be passed by council because of the perception that any decisions made by city members of council could be perceived as interfering with the election. So instead of putting this on the consent agenda, I've actually put this in open for discussion. There really shouldn't be much discussion because the content is actually just derived from the Municipal Elections Act. So this would provide some direction for potential candidates and members of the public who wish to learn a little bit more about the process and the procedures. You'll notice in there that there are a number of pages with regards to voting procedures for internet and telephone voting as well. In the report, just so that members of council and the public are aware, there are a number of about four or five or six or seven pages of clerk's responsibilities. So I've just put that in there for clarification. Near the end of the report, there is a list of timelines And I shaded out the areas of where we are in terms of the timeline. We have everything ready and set to go for January 1st. The reason why this is being brought forth now is that there are no election years to make sure that there are no perceptions of interference by this council beginning next year.
Thank you for that. Questions? Barbara?
And I noted in reading the document, 190 pages, that there could be changes. It is draft, and there may be forms added. Will this document, when it is finalized, when we have all of the information, when you have all of the information, and you are making it available to all 2018 candidates, which would include any members that are currently sitting who choose to nominate, will this document be available? It'll be available on the new southgatevotes.ca, by the way. Looks very nice. One-stop shopping. Can go there and look at everything. But if people have, will copies be available in the office or be made available to candidates? And I would suggest two-sided. If that was to be the case, definitely two-sided.
Three members of council certainly survive as the purpose of this to make sure that it is available, and it will be a live document that anytime municipal world or the province comes up with any changes or some of the regulations actually come into effect, which many of them will not come into effect until April 2018, it will be updated, and a lot of these forms are kind of a work in progress too, in case there are any changes that the province decides. One of the things is the province is currently working on the public consultation with this that is kind of updated or provided more direction, then we'll certainly remove it. In addition to, there is the candidates package, which will be available beginning January, which will have all the necessary requirements with regards to forms that have to be filled out in terms of the nomination. So all of that will be provided, and we'll make sure that everything is available on our website to make sure that everybody has it and everybody has it at the same time.
Thank you, Barbara.
Just to follow up, that your comment about being available January 2018, the forms and the nomination forms, and I noted in here that it would be made available May 1st, but my question was previously was, people are trying to get their 25 signatures, then they need the form in advance of May 1st if they want to be, you know, first one out the gate and nominating themselves May 1st. So I'm glad that you clarified that.
Mayor, members of council, so just to clarify, we are still going to be having some elections updates and newsletters that are going to be sent out as well. So the first one will probably go out in the next week or 2 weeks once we finalize some of that content in there. So again, we'll always make sure that we have that open communication with everybody, posting it on our website. That way, if there are any changes, everybody becomes aware. So that's something that we'll make sure that communication is heavy set with regards to anything.
With your permission, it might be a good idea to, and you may have already done this, I haven't been in Dundalk to read the electronic sign and sit there and read it all, but it would be great to put on the electronic signs as a, you know, the election is coming, are you interested in municipal politics, check out southgatevotes.ca or something similar, just to get people to start thinking about the next election.
Mayor, members of council, so that's part of in the elections plan, and once we approve things moving forward, everything will be available to whatever facility that we have available to us in terms of funds like that and posted work and whatnot. We'll be sure.
So thank you for that and this tome of information. The average voter does not need to read this. Okay. The answer is no. Thank you. So then a voter's guide, the province put out, that's what people probably want to read, right? So our process, this document is about the process you as the clerk managing the process so that none of us interfere with it. But primarily, the voters shouldn't get too distracted by this. And is there any other document that you anticipate creating or directing our voters to in addition to this? And what can you tell us about that and the timing of that?
So through Mayor, members of council, certainly, so there are a number of documents that we will be working on. First of all, a lot of the information is already on our site, anything that the Ministry of Rental Affairs and Housing has put out. So that document, as well as the candidate's guide, is already on there. What we will be doing internally is separating the voting procedures and making those available to the public to make sure that the public are aware that we have an alternative voting method that was passed by council back in March. So to take a look at southgatevotes.ca, we have a video there right now on how to, what alternative voting means and what the online and telephone voting is. In addition to that, we will also be providing a third-party candidate's guide, which I'm hoping we're currently working on. I'm hoping that it should be done by end of February so that we can make sure that everybody is aware of what those new financial rules are with regards to the election.
Before I go back to Barbara, third-party candidate's guide, mm-hmm. Is that a third party creating a candidate's guide or a guide for third parties?
Through Mayor, members of council, so the way that the Elections Act is written is that the third-party advertisers actually register themselves, so they're technically called candidates as well.
Okay.
So we're just making that document to make sure that everybody is aware of what those rules are and what they're expected to know for the election as well.
And those rules are going to be consistent across province.
Mm-hmm.
Barbara?
So just to clarify, voter's guide that Mayor is referring to, there's always been a voter's guide and a candidate's guide. And I think this municipal election procedures Bible, if you will, really explains it to candidates that the current incumbents have no say in where the advanced polls are being held or when, that so any speculation that the previous council interfered with, you know, the ability of other queue candidates getting their voters out to the poll was, you know, would be unfounded. And this is the guide for more for candidates to understand that, or for anyone who wants to make sure that we are hands off. If we want to run in the next election, we have only the same powers as anyone else who's running in the next election. Right? Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Okay. Any additional questions? So receive for information, and the information will be posted to the website as of January 1st, 2018. Distributed to all candidates to election candidates. All in favor? Carried. So that brings us to Public Works, I believe. Be resolved, the Council received staff report PW 2017-083 as information. The Council consider passing bylaw 2017-135 to amend the Southgate parking bylaw at the November 15, 2017 Council meeting. Who would like to move that? Jim, thank you. Thank you, John. Discussion? Barbara?
Through the chair, Jim, thank you for responding to my email about what drove this. Maybe it would be helpful to understand that, for everyone to understand what drove the change. If someone has a property and there's a sidewalk, and the lower part of the sidewalk is the boulevard. That's what you're classifying as the boulevard. The piece of property that's below the property line that a resident, you know, cuts the grass and shovels the snow, but you're saying that they can't park parallel in the driveway because it interferes with plowing, or are people not completely in on the boulevard and then half out in the road? Can you just explain that as to how it interferes with the plowing
Yeah, so, when we, if I recall correctly here, when we brought the parking bylaw, last year, or maybe it was the year before, even, there was some discussion that, Councilor Frew had, put in there about paved boulevard parking. So, subsequent to that parking bylaw, there was a report done on that paved boulevard parking piece, and, we didn't support that, initiative. But I guess maybe in hindsight, somehow we neglected to put boulevard parking into that, bylaw. So this is a little bit of catch-up, but yes, we do have some incidents where there's, some habitual parking that is in a boulevard that's below property line adjacent to the road, and when that occurs during winter especially, the plow sometimes has to swing out a little bit just to keep a little safe distance between a vehicle or whatever. So that ends up sometimes leaving the snow on the road at times. In some instances, the dealer owners look after it fairly quickly, but, it can be left there at times, and, we needed to bring this back into the forefront to be able to manage that right-of-way property properly for all kinds of incidents.
Thank you, Jim. Barbara?
So, when someone parks on the paved portion of the boulevard, or the grass portion of the boulevard, you're swinging out in order to avoid throwing snow and damaging someone's car, and so you're in, out of consideration for the vehicle, or the vehicle is potentially going to get hit by the plow. But we also have instituted, and we have a no overnight parking, for winter months. We have no parking on certain roads during the winter months. So we're creating a situation where people with more than one car can't have nowhere to park, possibly. And I'm just wondering how we can address that, or could this be just for the same period of time that they can't park on the road? So we're talking about snow removal.
Well, in that instance where we're challenged, it's more the snow removal. But we have all kinds of incidents where, just even recently, there's tables parked on boulevards. We're getting complaints from neighbors saying, do I got to look at this sailboat in front of my house? No, because it's not going to be allowed to stay there parked. So, there's, you know, again, if there's vehicles that are being parked that aren't licensed, there's different other mechanisms to use within the bylaw, but the definition of a boulevard was not there for us to help utilize.
Boulevard comes in two parts. First part is known as the outer boulevard by the curb. Then you have your sidewalk, and then you have the inner boulevard. So when you're addressing the boulevard, are you addressing from the curb or from the edge of the road to the property line, including the sidewalk?
Yes, it includes from property line right out to the road. And in some instances, there are curbs. Or sidewalks on there, but anything from property line that's considered within the right of way of the public space.
Yeah.
Now, if an individual wants to park on the property, on his property, is that going to be on? They have a driveway, single car driveway, and then they pave an area 90 degrees from that particular part of the driveway. On private property, would that be allowed?
Again, it would depend on what's parked there. There are other parts of the bylaw that refer to trailers can't be parked out front. Again, we use some leniency and latitudes with summer and those periods of time. We're not going around looking for these guys unless they're blocking sidewalks or doing something. But if they're inside their own property line and modify any of their parking spots. As long as they're not affecting the entrance out in the right of way, they would require an entrance permit for that modification. What they do internally there is kind of up to them. But if people are just parking on grass areas, I believe there is some teeth in the bylaw to address those type of situations. But if they internally modify on their property some of their parking space, I don't believe we have any control other than there's certain vehicles or trailers or those other boats and stuff that is defined that they can't be parked out front. They have to be in the side or behind is in the bylaw currently.
Just wondering, Jim, with a road like Yonge Street, how are we going to handle that? Because we've got houses that are basically past the property lines into the boulevard, let alone driveways. So just wondering how we're handling that.
Jim?
So in the current bylaw, Yonge Street from south from Victoria has no parking since the reconstruction of the road because we included bike lanes in there. So it's posted, there's not supposed to be. Now again, there is parking that's been down at the school and stuff, and that's going to continue to happen until something can get addressed down there with the school board. But I mean, as far as from young to old sort of thing, if you're overnight parking or parking at all in that section, you're not. Those are bike lanes, and they're established. They're in the bylaw, so that they are enforceable.
John, and then back to Jim.
Just a clarification. I was talking more about the driveways that are in boulevard range. That people probably thought were on private property,
yeah,
that are actually on road allowance.
Yeah, again, as long as the sidewalk isn't being affected, it is tight in some areas for sure. We're not going to be necessarily bothering those type of people unless they start parking out on the street or. But yeah, I'm sorry, I didn't quite follow what you're saying there, but I can see the instances you're referring to because, yeah, if that guy gets a larger vehicle, he could be out further and stuff. And there are a few circumstances.
Even their normal vehicles, their driveways are on town property all the time.
So,
just as long as you've got a plan to handle that.
It would be complaint driven that we would be monitoring that more frequently, but unless they're impeding the sidewalk, we're going to leave them alone.
Okay, Jim, and back to Councilor Jim.
Two quick question. What is the penalty?
Clerk will be submitting with the new bylaw to the ministry for the update of there is one component in the fines and charges there. And again, we do have some capabilities of some bylaw enforcement that we have currently, but working toward better mechanisms for that enforcement, and which would be more consistent than what we're doing now.
So just to clarify, I think I heard you say that if somebody has, so they've got an existing driveway entrance, whether it be single or double wide, and if they have space on their property to expand their parking once they get onto their property, then they don't need any additional permit from township to do that. And taking it to the extreme, because somebody paved their entire front yard. Theoretically,
I guess yes. I would have to check with building. There would be some restrictions to property line possibly. But as far as their entrance, if they are not modifying their entrance on the right of way, then they do not require a permit as far as anything I'm aware of.
Okay. Thank you. Any additional questions? Jim?
code that passed the bylaw about recreational vehicles. No recreational vehicle shall extend beyond the front face of the house. The mayor of the day was Norm somebody or other. I can still see the film. He was the first guy to get a ticket. He left his trailer outside.
Any additional questions on that report? Jim?
Just the other real change to this is that, I forget what section for sure, but there was where you could be parked out for up to a month before we could do something, and we ran into a lot of circumstances on there, and we've reduced that period to 1 week, so to be able to get on top of things a lot quicker, because a month is a long time.
Thank you. Additional questions, comments? All those in favor? Staff report 2017-084, Public Works, Southgate Solar LLC securities release. Be resolved that staff report Public Works 2017-084 be received for information, and that council authorize the release of the Southgate Solar LP-PCL securities in the amount of $50,000 as per Southgate Solar LP road use agreement. And who would like to move that? Barbara? And John? Discussion? Barbara?
Through the chair, Jim, this is just like any other organization that a business puts up a security that we're going to pave the parking lot and paint the lines, and there's going to be so many trees, and this is their security deposit for damage on the road. You're satisfied that everything's been addressed, and now it's just a formality to release those funds, right?
Basically, there is one little area of concern. It's very minor, but we do have an agreement through email that PCL will be voicing for the minor works that have to be done, and they're going to pay it. They don't want it to be involved with their security or whatever, so it's minor in nature, but it's just some cleanup of some areas where some hydro holes were installed. It's just minor. They don't have forces on there to do it, and that's kind of why this has been held back, but we do have confirmation that they're willing to pay for the work to do it. So it's very minor, so it's not $50,000 worth, it might be $500 worth.
Thank you, Jim. Additional questions or comments? So this comes straight from the solar agreement, and perhaps in the future, adding a link to that agreement might help people to say, you know, this is where you're citing that from. Any future expense that the municipality may incur in relation to road work or any related work is going to come from that community fund, right? That's our go-to place for any expense, right? Like, we don't have any other revenue stream other than just taxation?
I'm not sure. As far as any impacts on roadway that is because of the project, that's after this $500 thing is cleaned up, that's it. So we're not looking to the solar company to have any other kind of cost related to roads. I mean, if there's damage to the road that they cause, that would be a separate incident, but we don't see any of that. It's going to be normal roadway use from now on.
Any additional questions? staff report. Be it resolved that staff report PW 2017-086 be received for information, and the council approves and endorses the 2017-2018 winter operations plan for the TAPS department. Who would like to move that? Dale and John. Discussion? Jim? Yeah. Go ahead. I'm just looking for an overview of what changes might have taken place since the last version.
Yeah. So, council seen this, excuse me, before this format. We've used it last year, maybe the year before. 1 or 2 years, anyway. This is the OGRA format. Before that, we had our own plan. This covers a little bit more in depth, but the real changes are just equipment. A piece of equipment has come in and out of the fleet with the plow truck, and there are a couple gaps, but we wanted to get this to council that with some operators, who those operators are going to be, because we just closed those application on Monday, so we're going to be going the interview process. But a couple of those names would be tied to the city, but there's no major changes other than the equipment and personnel on the equipment.
Thank you, Jim. Jim?
You made a call. I mentioned sidewalks and Holston. Since that discussion, you've arranged for sidewalks to be cleared by Donald Logan. That snowfall we had on the Friday, the sidewalks on the west side were cleared, and the path to the school was cleared, but the sidewalks on the side weren't touched.
Jim?
Yeah, our agreement with him was to do just the west side and to the school. We never maintained those sidewalks on the east side before, other than at the bridge, keep the bridge open, but those were not maintained previously, and they weren't part of council direction for keeping sidewalks in the street.
So Jim?
Public safety cleaning is an organization's responsibility. Point 422.
Jim?
We currently do not service all the sidewalks in Dundalk either. I never have, and are not going to at this point in time unless council directs that for us to work towards. But yeah, there's sidewalks that aren't being maintained in the township.
Jim?
Should there be an accident on one of those sidewalks, who would be liable?
The township would be liable.
Through the chair. So in many municipalities, if you have a sidewalk in front of your house, it's the property owner's responsibility to clear that sidewalk within a certain period of time. Do we have such an animal in place that outlines that to the property owner? I know that I didn't have a sidewalk clearing mechanism go by my house in Etobicoke, so it was my responsibility, and if an accident happened on that sidewalk, yes, I'm sure the city would have been named, but they would have been coming after the property owner as well.
There's been previous reports. It seems like every year we bring a report about sidewalk winter maintenance to council, and we did discuss that previously, and some examples of other municipalities that use that system. But when it boils down to it, we've had discussions with the insurance providers and others higher up that the municipality's still going to be liable, even though there's a bylaw that you maintain, you're still going to be named as it's part of public property. So it's a tough sell. We've discussed it before. We bring it forward again. That's what council wishes to do and implement that strategy, but there's still going to be a loss on the municipality.
Jim?
a no-win situation. In the city of Toronto proper, you had 12 hours to clear the snow. You failed to clear it, the city would go in and clear it and build it again. But it is a problem of ever growing.
The one thing that in our operation information that we do show sidewalks that are maintained and that aren't maintained, so I mean that's part of our, I guess if there's a defense, but like in London, Ontario, that was the same policy on the back streets that you had to maintain your sidewalks.
So I wonder if staff anticipate that this conversation might evolve as a result of growth in Dada, as an example. Because I just think about primarily kids getting to and from school, and in the worst circumstances, you know, you've got snowbanks and kids are walking on the street, really, to get to and fro. So is this something that we should all have on our radar to consider differently going forward? Jim?
So yes, we have those thoughts in the back of our mind here. Currently, our latest subdivision, the Lozani, Centennial Heights there, we do not maintain sidewalks up in there. Going forward with the projection of growth in that, might be off a year or two, but 2022 or somewhere in that range, we have through development charges another sidewalk clearing machine. So that'll be up to, as these developments start to happen, council's direction, but we are prepared to do more sidewalks. It's going to take more manpower, another machine, to get more sidewalk done, and maybe we can incorporate more with what's already there and incorporate those sidewalks in to get some more. But yes, we have. It is on our radar. We are thinking of it, and it will be when for sure we roll out it.
Thank you for that. And before I go to Barbara, I guess what I'm finding is that sometimes in considering one particular expense, if you will, to the tax bill, if we're able to encapsulate it and say, you know, if this is what the masses want, this is what it will cost. It will cost you X amount more on your tax bill, and sure, we can allow whatever you want. So just something to think about. Barbara?
That was a good point. And I know from other discussions with regard to the development and the plan to have walking paths and a corridor to the school, that you were designing them to be wide enough to withstand a snow clearing machine down, or to be able to get equipment down in case of fire. I know that, like, that rail trail and I mean, we're not going to start clearing the rail trail. We can't possibly do that.
Jim?
As far as the rail trail, the snow groomer is going to go down it, because currently it's snow rail trail. The intentions for getting to school from the end of Rose Lane, say, excuse me, to Yonge Street on the trail that's there, that's been made of road wide almost, is that, yeah, kids may be able to go through there from, say, April till November. But once the snow starts flying, they've got to make their own path. We're not maintaining any of that to get to that school. They'll have to go around the traditional sidewalks to get up there. But we need to have that area that wide for us. If there's water main or sewer problems, that we can access it. So we would not be plowing it regularly. If there was an incident, we would snow clear in to get to do the work. But
thank you.
We are not maintaining that.
That's great. Thank you.
Dave?
Sidewalks in Dundalk and that, as far as keeping snow sidewalks, that's not zone rating. saying that we're doing a pretty good job in town right now for the amount of sidewalks we're clearing compared to what you look at villages south, north, east, or west of us here. And I'm not saying to reduce service or nothing, but we do a pretty good job compared to a lot of other municipalities. And if the higher level of service is going to be required in Dundalk in order to keep more sidewalks, we need to make sure the tax base that is coming from Dundalk warrants some of these extra costs. And I think if you take a look at what the tax base is, and I don't like going back to the way the old municipalities was, but take a look at what the tax base is for Agawam, total dollars, take a look at what the tax base is for the old program, and then look at the tax base for what Dundalk is. There's some pretty extreme big surprises where the max, where the tax dollars is being generated from. And it isn't from the village of Dundalk.
Dave? So I think, like, there's a point there for sure. I think down the road, if there was any change in level of service, because to me, the level of service that we're creating or if we were delivering in Dundalk related to sidewalks is core access to get to the schools, to get to the business section. If we want to go up and down every street and provide that type of arterial or connecting sidewalk access to those main routes on Main Street, we definitely have to look at more area rating or something, because there'd be significant cost. I think what Jim's looking at is expanding to, you know, keep up with you know, there's a lot of sidewalk that's going to have to be done just to get that those connecting links in place so that kids are able to walk to school after 8 o'clock.
Thank you, Dave. Any additional questions, comments? All those in favor? Carried. So, given the hour...
No, you came up one more.
Oh,
finish that.
Sure. Staff report PW 2017-087, West Great Boundary Agreement. Be resolved that staff report PW 2017-087 be received for information and that council consider the approval of bylaw 2017-143 being a bylaw to establish a road boundary agreement with the municipality of West Great. Who would like to move that? Dale and Joan, discussion?
So this is formalizing that boundary road agreement. In the past, this is one of my first tasks when I became public works manager, was to get a boundary road agreement that we never really had in stone with West Gray. It's still outstanding with Great Highlands. But anyhow, we used a template that was used for North Wellington and Warrington just prior to me taking this position. And it was scrutinized a little bit between myself and West Gray. But anyhow, it's that basic template. And we did have something kind of mapped out on paper of whose roads were whose and who was plowing and what. And there was some minor changes because we just, the kilometers were out of whack for we did less than what West Gray did, so we are now taking on one piece of extension of Side Road 61, and I believe it's their 15, if I remember correctly, that goes up towards Priceville, that will kind of even the score a little bit. That was one bone of contention that I always had a challenge with Ken Gould. He didn't want to take it to council because of it being a little bit of a difference. But basically, it's standard, it's the same of what practices we've done in the past. The other big difference with this from past what was done is that the town line that comes off of Highway 6 towards the railroad road, that was flip-flopped every other year or two between the municipalities. But this agreement leaves that section in West Gray's hands, so we won't be, we were pretty good on knowing when those dates changed and who was looking after that road, but there's more consistency now of knowing that that's their section of road, that if there's a problem, they're gonna be the ones looking at it.
Thank you, Jim. Additional questions, comments? Okay.
Sorry, by the way, West Gray passed this last Monday, I believe, so we have their signed copy just came in yesterday.
All those in favor? Carried. How long have you been in this role? You said it was your first job?
Too long.
Yeah, it's been 4 years.
Congratulations. Shall we celebrate with lunch?
Sure.
So, Barbara?
Move that we recess and resume at 1:15.
And move to resume at 1:15. Everybody good with that?